verse has indeed been particularly apt for this past year. For today's service, the PW has added a little bit to this title, making it side by side, one day at a time, as we are all doing what it takes to face the current climate in our daily, on a daily basis. With this in mind, we have two speakers this morning with a home and overseas insight into living with the coronavirus. Ms. Claire Robinson, who is an SIM missionary in Zambia, and Mr. Philip Veal, who is a doctor working for the Public Health Agency here in Northern Ireland. Sophie Shields, along with friends Jennifer Brown and Caroline Jones, will lead us in items of praise throughout the service today. May I just take this opportunity to thank all of those who have taken time to record for us today, and to Gillian and Neil, who have tweaked those recordings for our service. Thanks as well to Kirsty for playing, and Anita for reading, and Brian for piecing everything together for you live today. A few other announcements to mention. First of all, our midweek will be online again on Wednesday evening, when we will look at the second last in our series, Know God, Love God, and we'll be looking at Mark 14, considering extravagant love. And then on Thursday evening, we have our Zoom prayer time, and we'd love for you to join with us for that. We had a great crowd in for it on Thursday evening past, but there's always room for some more. Sunday School Bible class and Youth Fellowship will continue online next week. And can I thank all of those who have been contributing to our online work over these months. I want to thank all of you who came down on Thursday past with your envelopes. It was just so lovely to see people again, even though it was mask to mask, but it was lovely to see you here. We realized that it didn't suit everyone this past Thursday, so we're planning it again for Saturday, the 27th of February, again from 10 through to 12. Paul says in Philippians 4, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." So we rejoice as we sing our opening praise today. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. He came to all fear is gone. when one day across the river I'll fight life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I know He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future.
Our first video this morning is from Claire Robinson, who is working out in Makingi School in Zambia. She works with SIM. However, before that, she taught in Hazelbank Primary School alongside Kirsty and Hazel. So therefore, we certainly take great interest in Claire, and I think that you will enjoy her video today. Live, well, not live, well, it was live when it was recorded from Zambia. Claire.
So may I introduce Claire Robinson, whom I have known for 16 years since we started working in the same school together. And Claire has taught for many years now, Claire, I couldn't even work it out. But she's now a principal of Makingi School in Zambia. So Claire, as we do this interview, it is just after 11 o'clock in the morning here. What time is it with yourself?
Here it's just after 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We are just a couple of hours ahead of you at this time of the year.
Just a couple of hours. And that changes through the year, doesn't it? Because I think you can go to 5 hours ahead. Are you? Or?
No, when the clocks change, it's just 1 hour time difference. So for us, it's not such a challenge to talk to people at home compared to people from maybe New Zealand or somewhere like that. It's more challenging.
Yeah, yeah. And I do know your internet isn't always reliable. So it's good that we're able to talk.
We have chosen somewhere in the middle of the bush where the signal is actually quite good, so we're hoping it's going to stay connected.
So talking in the middle of the bush, some people would say Ahoghill's in the middle of the bush too.
They should come to Kazemba Makingi.
They would really know about it. Well, Claire, can you explain a little bit about yourself and your role as an SIM missionary worker?
Okay, so I am Claire, grew up outside Ballymoney. I'm the firstborn. I've got two younger sisters who both live in the Ballymena Cloch Mills kind of area. And as you said, I've been teaching, I think, 17 years now. Hazelbank was my second job just there in Bucknagh. I taught for 1 year in Coleraine before that. So, yeah, I've been teaching quite a while. And some of my interests, I enjoy like walking outside and reading when I get a chance to read something, and coffee drinking. I'm a bit of a...
You always coffee. Like your coffee.
But I do enjoy my coffee.
Good. So you went out just as a teacher at the start, didn't you, with SIM?
Yes. So while I was teaching in Northern Ireland, I had gained some experience of short-term mission trips going to different places, but I wanted to be able to use my teaching skills somewhere longer term and be able to just be able to get to know people and form better relationships than you can if you're maybe only in a place for 2 to 3 weeks. So that's what brought me out to Makingi in 2010 for a couple of years, and then I've come back this time 2015. So I came originally as the grade 4 teacher with some responsibility for staff development. But I was in that just maybe 6 or 7 months, and the head teacher of the school was deployed to another school. And that's when they asked me to take on the role of head teacher. So I've been doing that since about October 2016, somewhere around there.
Well, I do know from having chatted to you through the years that you wear many hats. You know, you're not just a principal. You were digging boreholes. You've had to work with the government. You've had to work with different agencies. How much of a challenge has that been for you?
Yeah, I was just talking to someone about that yesterday. If you had to write a job description, it would be very varied. I think for me, the thing is, if you can have that attitude where you're prepared to give something a go and try and ask people around you for the help and support that you need. Yeah, there's lots of things that you attempt to do that if I was a teacher at home wouldn't be part of that same job description. So yeah, like you said, quite a big part of my role is the development of the schools and the school's infrastructure. So a lot of my time has been spent on getting supplies and organizing bricks and cement and working with various tradespeople. So yeah, it's a challenge, and it's a challenge for them sometimes being able to understand me. So yeah, learning together and having that patience and developing relationships and getting to that point where you can understand each other and yeah, and work well.
Because I think a lot sometimes from over here, people have a very romantic fairy tale idea of what being a missionary is, and you're going out to help children. But I know from the past, kids are kids, and some want to learn and some don't want to learn. And really, although we have many differences, there's similarities as well to your work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's exactly right. Children are children anywhere all over the world. And I think the vast majority, obviously, they do want to get a good education. But yeah, you've got those same problems with discipline and yeah, just the different characters that you have in your class. That's the same as anywhere in the world. And sometimes I have got frustrated because even I have thought, yes, I'm coming to help children, and my day-to-day work at the moment is a lot of it is administrative, and sometimes I find that frustrating and not the most life-giving in some respects. But those are the things that need done at the minute that actually do help the children and hopefully benefit them in the long term. So it's remembering that some days it can be a challenge to remember that, when I'd rather maybe be in the teaching the lessons myself.
Well, on reflecting on that, Claire, getting used to a different culture and mindset takes time. And our theme for our service today is side by side, one day at a time. And in what ways has your experience just led you to taking things one day at a time?
I think in a lot of circumstances, especially at the beginning, you can make mistakes and faux pas, and I think that helps keep you humble and grounded. You have to take things one day at a time, because coming as an outsider into a different culture, there's so much that you just don't get. Sometimes you don't even realize that you're not understanding until someone, if you've got a good friend beside you, they can explain to you later, and sometimes you haven't even understood. So I think it's appreciating that, like you said, having someone that helps you to see inside the culture and understand it better is really invaluable as you get to know and you get to learn. And so trying to integrate with the staff that you work with. I have always tried to say to my teachers, you know, tell me if I'm doing something that's not right or if I'm doing something in a way that's not right. But it's taken time to get to that point. Really, initially, people would tell me what they thought I wanted to hear. But now I think I have got some people on the staff who are prepared to come and say, you know, that's not right, or, you know, be sensitive about that. So, but it takes time to develop that. It is day by day.
And it takes time to develop those relationships, you know, because you can be wary. Everybody can be wary of each other and it's building up that trust. But as you said, it's good that people are placed beside you, and God has placed many people beside you, Claire, through your time out in Zambia. But can you tell us maybe who God has placed with you so that you can be beside them as you go through this journey?
Yeah, I've got a lot of people beside me, some very close and then others further away. I've got very good support. Locally here in Zambia, I've got a friend here. If you could only see her behind the camera, Bumba is here. And We have been good friends since, I think, almost the we were right in McKinney about the same time in 2015. And we have, I think we've hit it off. Most of the time we get on well together. She came to work as a doctor at the hospital on government payroll. And through that time, she's led the hospital and now is working at the district level. So we've been a good support to each other. And I think it's been good that we haven't both been working in the same environment, because we can share our frustrations and just support each other through those things. Sometimes she listens to me, other times she doesn't. She just pretends. But
you can sort out, Claire. When you need one to do it. And what about your church at home?
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I have a very good support network from Northern Ireland, both in my own church at Glen Abbey and other local churches near where I've worked before, your own church, people in my mum's church, and just lots of them keep in touch in different ways. Some people are very good at sending a WhatsApp, other people email, like little video chats every so often. But my own church has a support group that calls me the final Thursday of every month. There's about 13 people that would come, and at the moment we're meeting on Zoom because they can't come together, but normally they would have met in one house. We would chat maybe for half an hour. They get an idea of how things are going, and I think that video works well because instead of an email, they can tell how I really am. You know, if I come on and the tone of voice isn't very upbeat, they can tell things are difficult, and I think that keeps it real and it keeps a strong connection between us. And then after we've chatted through some things, then we'll spend time praying together for McKinney, for myself. And yeah, then they keep in touch the rest of the month through messaging and so on. And as they prepare to come home, then they're very involved in helping me with the practical side of things. If I need a vehicle to get around, or if I needed somewhere to stay, or even down to like bikes or something like that when you come home and it's cold.
Yeah, and they've been a great support to you, especially when you come home. We all love it when you're able to come home. But it's great that we can see you on Zoom too. And yet, even if you came home now, we wouldn't be able to hug you because we're all going through this pandemic. But how has it affected your school and maybe church life for you, Claire?
Our schools first closed at the same time as they did in Northern Ireland, that same week. And we didn't have anybody back in school until the 1st of June. And then that's when we brought the grade sevens back in. The examination classes were allowed to reopen. So we had to have strict guidance about social distancing, wearing masks, and all of those measures in place. And then during that time, we tried to provide some home learning for our children. Now, internet learning is just not an option here. And when I hear my friends talk about what to do, I think that's a blessing. We provided packs of work for 3 weeks at a time. And then we tried to get parents to come collect those. And then after 3 weeks, they brought them back for marking and collected the next work. So we did that for one term, for grade one up to grade six. And then everybody was allowed to come back from September until December, when we closed again for the end of the academic year. So everything seemed to go fairly well. We were a bit apprehensive of opening the school at that time, but then it settled down and nobody got sick at that time. But it's been different since we got this new strain from South Africa, end of December into early January. We have had some teachers that have tested positive and some children. So now that we've opened again for the start of the next academic year, there's a different feeling this time. We're being stricter on our screening process in the morning. We're trying to do temperature checks just to see if anybody's got fevers. And we've got similar challenges to home. You know, you try to contain them in one class so they're not mixing too much, but then you dismiss them at the end of the day and they all travel home on the same transport packed tightly together. So we just ask, pray for us for that, for protection for all the children and staff.
And how's the impact been on the hospitals?
Again, in the early stages, I would say in that first wave, we had some cases, but not very many requiring treatment in isolation. The symptoms seem to be fairly mild. But again, with this second wave, we're seeing it's having more, what would you say, more severe effects on people. And especially, it still seems to be those that have other underlying health problems like hypertension and diabetes and HIV positive people. Those are the ones that there have been a few fatalities now, but it's much more widespread in the community. And so the hospital and the district, they have a lot of work to do now in the contact tracing and testing and trying to follow up and contain it. But you've got some people who take it seriously, but then a lot of people in the community, there's some that just don't even believe it's real. And so the challenge is sensitizing all those people to wear masks and to isolate, have tested positive.
Okay. Yes, it's just as challenging times for us all, no matter where we are. But as we come to an end, Claire, what are some of the smiles and special moments that God has blessed you with? And that's either within the school or your church life or making an apple tart when you're able to get the ingredients, just something that makes you smile.
Well, the children do make you smile every day. You've got, you know, some child that comes along and makes you laugh about something. Like I was saying the other day, a child came to the office door and came right up into my face and said, "Miss Robinson, I've forgotten my mask." And she was right up in my face. So maybe I shouldn't be laughing at things like that. But yes, the children always make you smile day by day. They can bring joy even when you're frustrated and you're facing challenges. And then I think other times I catch myself smiling. It's probably when I'm standing in the middle of some hardware store or something, talking about Comforce wire or, you know, specifications of different things. And I just think, how on earth did I end up in this position doing this? And just the daily, you know, sharing life with the people I live with, and laughing at the usual silly things.
Yes. Well, prayer points, as you say, just praying for the pandemic and how you're going to handle that just in the next wee while. Anything else specific that you... Hello? You're still there. I think you're still there. There we are.
Yeah, we're still here.
Joys of technology. Anything else specific that you might just like us to add to that?
Just as I said, the protection and the safety of everybody in the community would be good. You could pray for me for wisdom to know when to come on home assignment. I'm supposed to come in April, but as you said, I want to come when I'm able to see all of my family. I might not be able to see all my friends and interact with churches in the way I usually do, but just for wisdom to know, by this stage I normally would have something booked, but at the moment I don't have anything planned. So just for wisdom to know when to do that. And for the school, when I would be home and home assignment, I'm trying to pass on some more of my roles and responsibilities to Mr. Mbango, the deputy head. So pray for him. I think that he would be willing to take those roles on, and that he would develop the skills and experience and enjoy that role as well. Oh, something bite me.
I'm glad.
Sorry, was it
here? No, because I know that's your end goal, is to pass it on somebody else. So and then just see where.
Yeah, Ango has shown potential. He's able to handle the school. If I need to be out for a week doing something, he runs the school very well. So we are trying to speak as a management about strategically putting things in place that would encourage him to stay at the school, and we're trying at the moment to work out a plan that he would commit to 5 years, and that we'd be able to help him upgrade to his degree. Prayer around that we'd be able to put something together that gives him job security, but also then gives us more at the school, because I don't believe a Mzungu or a white person should be the head forever and a day. I want to pass that on to someone else, to a local person.
Yeah. Well, Claire, thank you so much for going into the middle of the bush with Boomba there, our wonderful videographer. So thank you so much, and it's lovely just to be able to see you.
Yeah, you're welcome, and thank you to all of you. I know you've got some people there that know me and other people that maybe have never met me, but thank you to all of you just for praying and for your interest. And hopefully if I get home, I can connect with you somehow while I'm in Northern Ireland.
Yeah. I know it's important for you to see your family, especially your mum. So, well, we'll pray for that. Well, look, have a good day. Bye.
Okay. Bye. Bye.
Wasn't that remarkable to be able to watch her out there in Africa? I can remember over 20 years ago being in Africa, and back then we had to use a satellite phone that cost us £5 a minute just to be able to phone somebody in a very crackly line at home. It does make the world seem so much smaller than it was before. But let's just take a little bit of time and come to the Lord and remember Claire in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this call that you have placed upon Claire's life, and we thank you that you have equipped her for the call, and that as she has gone out there, you have used her within that school. We thank you for all of the children that she works amongst. We thank you for the staff there, and pray that you would just continue to equip the staff, that you would build them up spiritually as they seek to set an example to the boys and girls. We want to thank you particularly for the 20 orphan children and vulnerable children within the school, and thank you for those who have been supporting them, even from over here in Northern Ireland. We pray that you would keep the children safe as they travel back and forward to the school. Be close to them, Lord, and we pray that for those who aren't yet Christians, that they would see the example of their teachers, that they would hear the message coming from ones like Claire, and that they would realize that Jesus died to save them from their sins. And for those who are Christians, we ask that you would help them to grow and mature in their faith. Grant Claire wisdom. Help her to know when it is right for her to travel back home again for a break before heading out there once more. Grant her wisdom in how she prepares the teachers out there, and indeed the vice principal, to maybe one day take over the leadership of the school, and guide her as far as future plans for her life are concerned. Just let her know your will. Help her, Lord, to understand your plan in these things. And Lord, as we speak about your plan, we realize that much in our congregation has been upset over this past year, and one of those things is the PW. We realize that there is a great sadness that the ladies have not been able to join together as they were accustomed to do. But yet we thank you for the comfort and challenge that has gone out through the vlogs. We thank you that the PW committee has continued to be active in reaching out to their members. And Lord, we pray that you would bless the PW as they look forward to uncertain days in the near future. And we pray that you would guide them as well in plans for the distant future, just to know your will. And Lord, we pray for our land at this time. We realize that Claire was talking about the rise in COVID cases over in Zambia. And Lord, we pray that you would grant wisdom to the government there. We also pray that you would grant wisdom to our government here, that you would help them to know what is right to do. We thank you that at the minute we can see that our number coming down, but we pray for those, even in our own congregation, who have COVID at this time. We ask that you would restore their health to them. For those with long-term symptoms from COVID, we pray that you would reduce the effect of those symptoms in the days ahead. And Lord, we think of the lives in our own province that have been lost through COVID over this year. But Lord, we think of other ways in which lives have been lost. We realize that during this year, over 1,000 babies have lost their lives due to the abortion law that has been thrust upon us. We ask that you would help our politicians to take a stance on this, that even though COVID may be at the top of the agenda at the minute in so many people's minds, that this also is something that is of essence to be dealt with, that needs to be dealt with now. And Lord, we pray that you would help our politicians to do that. And we see also that there is pressure being put on the government today regarding conversion therapy. And we realize that there is a bill just sitting ready to go through the Houses of Parliament at the minute. And so, Lord, we pray that you would thwart the hands of those who would seek to prevent your work being done. We realize, Lord, that conversion is at the very center of the message of the church, that we have sins, no matter what they are, sins of all types in our lives, and we need to be cleansed and forgiven for those sins, and we need to be converted. And yet we realize if this bill goes through as it stands, that even the opportunity to preach about conversion would be almost outlawed. And so we pray that you would stop the hands of those who would seek to pervert your truth, and that you would guide our politicians in taking the stance that needs to be taken. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to hear from these different folk today. We pray that you would bless us through their messages, whether it is a message in word or a message in song. And we pray, Lord, that each of us would be encouraged in our walk with you, and that we are able to walk side by side with our God. So hear our prayers now as we offer them in Jesus' name. Amen. We are delighted that Sophie Shields has allowed us to use some of her pieces for our service today. And this first one that she's going to sing is called Distractions. And the words will be appearing on your screen, and feel free to sing along at home. Distractions.
up in the morning, what's the first thing that we do?
Thank you very much to Sophie, and we'll hear from her again in a few minutes. And those were really challenging words. We're now going to hand over to Anita for our scripture reading this morning.
The reading this morning is taken from Philippians chapter 2, verses 1-8. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being in one spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross.
Well, you've heard Sophie Shields sing to you already, and now she's going to be joined by friends Jennifer Brown and Caroline Jones. And this is an absolutely beautiful trio, so please listen along.
Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost away. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing.
You are the one we adore.
That was really lovely. Now we're going to see a little video from Dr. Phil Veal. I actually officiated at Philip's wedding back quite a number of years ago. But you will maybe have seen him on television over this past year. He has been on a number of times in a very official capacity to do with the health agency here in Northern Ireland. Philip is a Christian, and today he's going to talk to you about what it means for him to be a Christian in the present environment.
Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to come and share a little with you this morning my experience as a Christian doctor working in the context of a pandemic. I hope that whatever I share this morning may be some help to you, as I know we are all facing challenges at these times. Some of you will know me, but for those who don't, my name is Philip and I'm a medical doctor. For a number of years I worked as a GP, and perhaps some of you here have had the missed opportunity to come and see me. I hope I looked after you well. But in more recent years, I've been working as a public health doctor. Now, people often ask me, what is a public health doctor? And really, my role is to control the spread of infectious disease. So if we go back to before the pandemic, perhaps my typical work might have been, if there was an outbreak of meningitis in a school, being involved in getting all the children assessed and treated and keeping them safe. Or perhaps if there was an outbreak linked to a restaurant, investigating that together with environmental health in a local council to find the source and take measures to make sure it didn't happen again. Or if you have kids, maybe you have been vaccinated, I would have been involved in running vaccination programs together with colleagues in general practice. But my work, much like everyone else, has changed entirely through this pandemic time. And although professionally I'm a doctor, my real identity is as a follower of Christ, who's someone who seeks to live and serve him, who often fails, but is so grateful for God's grace for forgiving me on every time. And I try my workplace to try and serve God through my work as best I can. And I just want to share with you really three things I have learned as I've worked through these turbulent 13 or 14 months. And the first thing is, I have limitations. I have limitations. The last 14 months have been a bit of a blur for me. It just seems a week or two ago I was going back into work after Christmas 2019 to my office, when I was wheeled into BBC television studios to go on Good Morning Ulster, then walked around the corner to the Stephen Nolan show, and then coming out on my hands and knees after that about this new virus in China. And since then, work really hasn't stopped. It's been incredibly busy. I think in August, I pretty much worked every single day of that month. It has been difficult, it has been draining, and I have two lovely children at home who are being homeschooled and all that goes with that. And I'm thankful for a very supportive and dedicated wife, Emma, who has really been tremendous support to us as a family. But it has been difficult. But I recognise it has been difficult for us all in many ways. Some are struggling to keep businesses going at this time. Some are struggling with caring duties for relatives or providing homeschooling. Or in other ways, it's been so, so difficult. And that was something I very much learned. Towards Christmas this year, after working flat out for 12 months, it was really taking its toll on my mental well-being. I had that awful feeling of dread in the pit of my stomach. Sleep was hard to come by, and work was becoming more and more difficult. And this is not unexpected. The science shows us that one in four of us will experience difficulties at some stage in our lives with feeling perhaps very anxious or feeling very down or struggling with day-to-day life. And with God's help, with family's help, I'm feeling more like myself now. And I just want to say, if there's anyone watching this, there's so much you can do. We are created by God as emotional beings. Isn't it wonderful we can experience joy and happiness and delight? And sadness is an important part of our lives too. But we also live in a world that is not as it should be. And sometimes these emotions get slightly out of control and need specific treatments or options to control them. And Christians are no different, that they can experience this. If you are struggling at this time, I encourage you to think of things you can do to help yourself. Exercise is wonderful, not just for physical health, but your mental well-being too. And don't misunderstand me. I don't mean going on the rowing machine for an hour every night. I know the Reverend Neely likes to do that, but that's maybe not for all of us. A short walk in the garden, even sitting in a cool evening wrapped up, enjoying the fresh air, is all tremendously beneficial. Try to make time for that. And try to keep in contact with others. More difficult in times of pandemic, but thank God for the opportunities we have through Skype and Zoom to contact each other, or even an old-fashioned telephone call, or even a letter. Let's keep in touch with each other. Human contact is vital. We are designed for it, and we need it. But if there's anyone watching this morning is still really struggling, I'd really encourage you, have a chat with your doctor about it. Don't believe what you hear in the news. We have an excellent health service. We have GPs and other services who can do so much for people who are struggling. Please do seek out that help. I certainly learned through this that I have limitations and I needed to take action to get myself back to where I should be. The second thing I learned is that science has limitations. Science has limitations. In the Western world and in Northern Ireland, we are no different. Increasingly, society believes that science has explained everything and that science has explained away God. There is no need for God because we've explained everything through science. And I am a scientist myself, and I see the benefits of science in so many ways, from the cars we drive, to the technology I'm using to speak to you now, to the treatments we can give to people. Science is wonderful. It's a gift of God that we're able to describe and understand our world. But it does not explain away God. It has limitations. For example, for many years, scientists and doctors have prepared for the next big pandemic, the pandemic we are living through now. And the wisdom was that it would be a new type of flu would come. And millions was spent preparing specific treatments, thinking how we'd identify vaccines. And look what has happened. It's been a virus that no one had thought of as capable of causing a pandemic. Or before this pandemic, the wisdom was that wearing face masks was not worthwhile. It would not stop spread of infection outside of a hospital setting. Or that closing schools wasn't a good idea because it wouldn't stop the spread of infection. And yet both have happened. And both have had an impact in saving lives and preventing the spread of disease. So science is constantly changing and evolving. And what is seen as true one day will not be true the next. It has limitations. But even more importantly, I feel, than that, is that science can explain the why. Sorry, science can explain the how of life, but it cannot explain the why of life. For example, if we ever see a sunny day here, and as I speak, it's snowing outside, but imagine a sunny day and you're standing outside watching a beautiful sunset. Science can explain why the sun is the colour it is. It can explain how the rays of the light sun reach my eyes. It can explain how the eyes translate this into an image through the brain. It can explain why it makes me feel joy and happiness through release of chemicals in my body. But it cannot explain why these things are so. Why I find joy in that. Why these things happen like regular. Why we exist. Why there is a point to life. And we know that there is a world beyond the scientific, the world of the supernatural, God in charge of all, God who created the earth, God who created us to serve and worship him, and I praise him for that. Science has limitations. It cannot explain the why of life, and I, through this pandemic, this has been very much reinforced to me. If anyone's interested in exploring this topic in more detail, I'd really recommend John Lennox's book called Can Science Explain Everything? You need to concentrate when you read it, but it is very readable, and it is a really deep insight into how science has its limits. And the third thing I want to share with you, and the thing that brings me great joy, that I have relearned during this pandemic, our God has no limits. God has no limits. It has been difficult during this time. And don't we, when you read the Bible and the life of Jesus' followers, or look at history, church history, at times God's church has grown amazingly, that his followers have been greatly blessed on earth. And we praise God for those times. But also, don't we read of times of persecution and suffering as a group of believers throughout history and even today in some countries? Or into each of our own lives, some of us suffer really profound hardships and difficulty. And it is part of our walk with God. It is difficult for us to fully understand, but we accept the Bible, that all things work to good for those who love him. That through this somehow, God works to make us more like him, to ready us for our future life with him in heaven. And a verse that has been really helpful to me throughout this, that I've thought on again and again, is Hebrews 13 and 8. You'll know it well. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So the God and his son Jesus that I read about in the Bible is the exact same God today. The God that existed in the time of previous pandemics, the God that has existed at other times of human hardship and wars and other challenging times is the same God. His love does not change. His compassion does not change. His promise to us that he will never leave us nor forsake us does not change. And I have found that a tremendous source of strength as I've struggled and tried my best to serve him, to love my family and love him through this pandemic. And I encourage us all to hold on to that truth, that God does not change. Nothing of what has happened during this pandemic has taken him by surprise. It's part of his great plan. And we trust in him. And we recognize and confess that, God, you have no limits. And we praise your name for that. So as I close, I hope that's been helpful to you. I have learned my own limits. I've been reminded that science has limitations. And praise God, I've relearned that God has no limitations. As we walk this path together as followers of him over the coming months and perhaps years, let's seek to do it side by side as followers of him. I think 1 Thessalonians 5 and 11 is helpful. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as, in fact, you are doing. For the pandemic to be brought under control is beyond just the efforts of doctors and government. It needs the efforts of all of society. And I suggest that as a body of people who confess Christ as Saviour, known as his church here on earth, there's a wonderful opportunity for us here to be known for showing love to others in practical ways. Let's all think of a way we can do that, be it calling with a neighbour, in our approach to homeschool, and finding ways to help serve them in a different way through church at this time, or just by praying for other people. Let's all find our way to show God's love in these times. And I recognise that some people perhaps do not accept the science or what they are told about coronavirus. If that applies to you, can I ask you to consider, is there still a way you can show God's love to other people at this time? Perhaps you could provide care or support, or just call with people or pray for people who perhaps hold a different view to you, but are still walking through this difficult time together. Let's perhaps grasp an opportunity that you have to show God's love to others. Thank you for your time this morning. Can I just close with a very short word of prayer? God, we thank you that you're a God of love. We thank you that you sent Jesus to die for us. And we thank you that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. It has been difficult in these months, And we have all struggled in different ways. And we confess at times we have perhaps let you down in our attitudes. But we thank you for your marvellous grace that your love does not change. And Lord, I pray for everyone in this church meeting this morning that you would be with them. If they are suffering, speak into their lives and be with them. If there is illness, Lord, please heal and be with the families. Lord, help us to seek opportunity to practically show your love to other people, to really grasp this opportunity to be known as your followers here on earth. And Lord, we pray for our country, we pray for those making decisions, and we pray, Lord, that soon this pandemic may pass and we'll be able to spend time together as a church family with each other and in your presence again soon. We ask this in our wonderful Saviour's name. Amen.
I do want to thank Philip Veal very much for recording that for us. Just lovely to hear that insight as a Christian doctor during this pandemic. So a big thank you to him, and thanks again to Claire for earlier on, and as well to Sophie for singing to us. And we now come to our closing praise. I will bless his name, and this will be sung again for us by Sophie. The words will be in the screen, so we do encourage you to sing along with us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you that you are the faithful God who has said that you will never leave us nor forsake us. You've reminded us that you will be with us even unto the end of the age. And therefore, there is a great comfort in knowing that you are by our side each day. And we thank you that we can stand together, even though we may not physically be together, that yet because we share a love for the same God, because we seek to serve you faithfully in our lives, we have this comfort in knowing that we serve you side by side. So we pray that you would continue to encourage us through this service today, that you would bless us through all that has been said and help us to think about these things and to remember these folk in prayer. Now, Lord, watch over and protect us, bless us and use us. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.